Welcome to FosNorth, the virtual edition. We would like to thank all our sponsors and partners in this difficult situation. Our gold sponsors, Luxoft and Ansible by Red Hat. Our silver sponsors, ITRS Group and Make It Right. Our base sponsors. Our partner projects, the open source community and the region of Gothenburg. And a huge thanks to our awesome community. This would not have been possible without you. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Frank Kalisek. Without further ado, the stage is yours.
Thanks a lot for the virtual stage. First of all, I really am really happy to be here, to be able to speak here at this event. And thanks a lot to the organizers who made this possible. I'm sure turning a real in-person event into a virtual event in just a few days is a huge challenge. So I'm really, really happy to be here, and it's nice that we can all come together, at least virtually, here from the open source free software community. And yeah, great, and thanks a lot to everybody who made this possible. Let's start with the talk. So the topic is, as you know, why the GPL is great for business. So usually I talk a lot about Nextcloud, as a product or community and so on. I don't want to do this too much here. It should be more like a generic talk. I will mention Nextcloud a few times because there are some things that are relevant for the discussion. But overall, this is not about Nextcloud. So if you want to learn more about Nextcloud, then you're in the wrong talk. This is about more theoretical, legal business perspective, why the GPL is great for business. Okay, let me introduce myself. Frank Kalisek, I'm a free software open source developer for a long time. I think it's over 20 years now, so it's really a long time, a long journey. I founded lots of different things, for example, the Open Desktop Org Network, some of you might remember, User Data Manifesto, an idea for to have some written down principles for handling of user data, privacy, which is also like more and more relevant nowadays, of course. Then I founded OwnCloud and the successor Nextcloud, was very active in the KDE community for a long time. I will talk a little bit about this later. I'm involved in the W3C a little bit, where I'm invited expert to work on some standards, fellow of the Open Forum Europe, which is a lobby organization on the European level for open source and free software. And since a few months, also an advisor to the United Nations, where I helped them together with a group of other people to develop their open source and intellectual property guidelines. Okay, but today I want to talk about free software and the GPL is great for business, basically. And I have this divided up in three parts. First is to talk a little bit about free software and open source licenses. Some of you might know this already, or the details here, but I think it's important for the discussion to understand how the licenses work and what it really means. Then I want to talk a little bit about different open source business models, different ways to work with software, how to try to pay for development, and so on. And then the end of the day, at the end of the talk, why the GPL is great for business, of course, with the conclusion. Okay, let's start with the licenses. Okay, I'm sure you all know this guy, Richard Stallman. This was a photo I took from him during an event. He's of course the person who came up with the four freedoms, with the GPL, with the FSF, and many, many other important things. So he basically started his work from the idealistic perspective to think about freedoms that users and developers of software should have. And he came up in the 80s with those four freedoms. The first is the freedom to run the program as you wish for any purpose, which means if you have a program, you can use it for everything you want. There should be no restrictions for usage. For example, there should be nothing in the license that says, hey, you can use the software, but not for this and this purpose, or not in this and this environment, or this and this time, or any other restrictions. So you should be able to run it as you wish and for any purpose that you want. And then the second freedom is the freedom to study how the program works and to change it to understand how it works. This means that you need to have access to the source code. That's very important, because if you have access to the source code, you can actually understand how it works and you can change it and modify it. I think this is one of the things that are super important, because with this freedom, we can all learn from each other. So if someone wrote something interesting, other people can look how it works and can learn and can improve it. That's one of the key things, because only with that we can build on top of the work from each other. The third is the freedom to redistribute copies so you can help your neighbor. It's funny that I mentioned neighbor at the time. I don't know how nowadays we would call, probably say, people on the internet or something. But at the time, I guess software was distributed physically to your neighbor. But the point here is that you should have the right to give the software to everybody, which means that, you can redistribute it. And everybody should have access to it, or can ask someone, hey, can you give me this software? I like it. And the person should have the right to give it to you. And then the fourth, which is basically puts everything together, the freedom to distribute copies of your modified version, right? This is where it becomes really interesting. Because if you then change the software, then you should also be able to distribute that. And this then means that software gets better and better all the time if it's passed around. And again, access to the source code is mandatory here. Okay, a little bit later, in the 90s, another group, the Open Source Initiative, came along with another definition. So this is the open source definition. But it's very similar. I mean, in spirit, it's the same. There are like tiny, 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 tiny changes, differences in detail, but overall it has the same spirit. It means that you can redistribute your work, that you should have access to the source code. Derived works should be possible, as I mentioned earlier. The integrity of the author source code should be guaranteed. That's a bit new, that's a special aspect. And then there should be no discrimination against persons or groups or field of endeavor or anything else. The license should always be included. I mean, obviously, right, if you get a software and you don't have the license, then you don't know what you're allowed to do with it. The license should not be specific to a product, which means that there should be a generic license that's applied to a product. Not every product should have its own license. license might not restrict other software. You should not say, hey, if you run my software, you're not allowed to use this other software. That's weird. And license must be technology neutral. But overall, the open source definition is a very similar idea to the four freedoms and what's developed in the GPL. Okay, now I mentioned the GPL. So what is this? What is this license thing in the first place? I think for that it's important that we first understand what a license is and for what, why it's needed. The thing is, if you create a software, for example, or a picture or a song or something, then this is your personal intellectual property. This is basically the case in every country on this planet, that if you create something, and it can be virtual, like software or a song, then you own it. And then, of course, if you only own it, that's a bit boring because no one else can see it or use it or hear it or whatever. And of course, the idea is that you give it to someone else. Only then the other people can benefit from your work. But then if you give it to someone else, you give it together with a software and with a license, I'm sorry, the license, because the license then defines what the person can do with it. Okay. You can basically say, here is my song, but you can not redistribute it, or you can only listen to it on Sundays, or you can do whatever with it. Right? And this is the same with software. If you distribute software, you give it together with a license where it's defined what the person can do with this license. Okay? Or with the software. So, and there are different license types, and they're usually grouped into individual areas. So I have here this graph here with these five different areas on the bottom, from public domain to trade secret. And I want to talk a little bit about each of those classes of licenses. Okay, the first one on the left is what's called public domain. It basically means, hey, I created this thing here, the software, for example, and I give up ownership. I just give up ownership. I give it to everybody. Right? Now everybody owns this software. Was common in academia in the 60s, 70s, 80s. But this is something that's legally not possible in a lot of countries. So, for example, in Germany, where I'm from, you can't give up ownership of something. Something always needs to be owned by someone. You can't say, I give this somehow to the public. There's not nothing like that. So that's a bit difficult. But the second area, the permissive licenses, they are a little bit more in this direction. You keep the ownership of your software. If you create something, you keep the ownership, but you allow others to use it, of course. This is like the BSD, MIT, Apache style licenses. The licenses are very short. You can read it if you want. It's basically do what you want with it, just don't sue me. That's basically the summary of those licenses. It's also common in academia, 70s, 80s, and this is very common. A lot of free software, open source, is under BSD, MIT, or Apache license. The third area is then the protective licenses. These are licenses that are called copyleft licenses. Copyleft, of course, a joke to copyright, copyleft. It means if you make a derivative work of this and distribute it to others, then you have to provide a source code under this license. These are the GPL and the AGPL licenses, 80s, 90s, and this is what's pushed forward by the Free Software Foundation, by Richard Stallman and others. It basically means that if something is open, free software or open source, then if you change it and redistribute it, always basically has to stay under this license. This is why it's always also called protective free software licenses. The fourth area is, of course, that the proprietary licenses. These are the licenses of Microsoft and macOS and Oracle and so on. It basically, not always, but most of the time, boils down to you can use my software if you pay. Okay, then this is the license. Usually you cannot modify or study or distribute it, and this is just a standard proprietary software business here. Okay, and then trade secret is then the extreme. I'm not going to cover that. It basically means I have something, but no one is ever allowed to see it or use it or whatever. It's like completely secret, which is, well, not very useful if you want other people to use your software, of course. Okay, so these are the different software licenses. And that's nice. Of course, in the 90s, there was also this guy came along. You might know him, Linus Torvalds, of course. He had this quote, the goal is world domination. So it's a bit put out of context here, of course, but it basically means what he wanted to say is we really, really want to have our free software, our open source software be successful. So we really want to, not only as a hobby, I mean, as Richard Stallman said, yeah, one person passes it on to your neighbor, that's nice. But the idea is, of course, hey, let's really make this the dominant software model in the world. Let's get rid of the proprietary software as much as possible, and let's make open source and free software really dominant. This, of course, has a lot of consequences. First of all, it would be great to be paid to write free software. This is where the whole discussion with business model comes into play, because it's nice to write software as a hobby, but the idea is that if you really want to compete with the big software companies and Microsoft and the Oracles and the Googles and so on, then you need to have a way to get paid somehow for it. But that's, of course, a bit of a conflict with all these freedoms and these rights, what I mentioned earlier, okay? I also have a personal story here a bit. As I mentioned earlier, I was involved in KDE for a long time, since the late 90s. Of course, some of you, most of you, I guess, know KDE. It's a completely community-driven project where everyone can contribute and commit. It's 100% free software. There is no company behind it. There is no real, no one owns it. No one makes any money with it. It's not really, there's no leader or something. It's just a complete community crowd-organized project, which is nice. I mean, KDE is a very successful project, of course. But one of the things that I and others noticed is that there's a problem with rotating team members. What does it mean? It means that a lot of people join the KDE community when they were like students or even younger than that, and they contribute for a few years, but then at some point they are finished their studies and they start a real job and start a family and other things, and then they no longer have the time to contribute to a free software project. So now they're really need a real job with real payment because they need to pay for things. Okay, it was always the question, isn't there a way that we can somehow hire people to work on free software in their free time, not only as a hobby? That's a challenge. That's of course a challenge. It's also the topic of this talk, obviously. Because as I mentioned before, everybody can use the software. Everybody can distribute it, you can change it, you can whatever, everything you want with it. So the question is, what our customers are paying for? Because in economics, it's usually there's an exchange of things, right? Someone gives you something, and in exchange, you give the person money, right? But if you won't expect money from someone, what can I give to this person that a person can't have in the first place without giving you money? So it's a bit of a challenge with free software and open source. And for that, I want to look a little bit into open source business models. So what I did was I looked at a few months ago, I looked up at a Wikipedia page. There's actually a Wikipedia page about open source business models, where lots and lots of those business models are listed. Lots of them, you will see it in a second, are a bit weird and not very practical. But I think it's still interesting to understand how this could work and how someone could make money with free software so that they can pay people and do it really the work full time. The first example that's listed there is selling branded merchandising. That's actually something a lot of open source projects do. If you go to FOSDEM or some of the other open source projects, sometimes you see software projects who just sell like t-shirts and cups and other things with their logo in it. And they make a little bit of money and then they use the money over the year for things. And the software is of course free and everybody can use it. And the hope is that a lot of people like the software and use it so they later then buy a t-shirt. That's the idea here. And that's a lot of projects do that. But in my experience in lots of different open source projects, that's nice. You can make a few euros with that, but it's definitely not enough to pay one or several full-time developers to work on that. Especially, I mean, you really need a software that's really successful, really like competitive to build up this fan base so that people later sell buy t-shirts. And to build this software, you really need a lot of people, and that's not, you can't pay this with t-shirts, unfortunately, in my experience. The second thing is what you could do is selling software as a service. That's something that's usually done or possible with server-side software. So there are some examples. I don't know, maybe there is company like Redis, I will come back to them later, where it's a free software project, you can download the software, you can change it, you can do whatever you want. But you can also from the company buy Redis as a service, basically, a hosted version of Redis, and you pay for that. That's an interesting business model, works for some companies. It really depends, because at the end of the day, it's a bit of a conflict of interest, because then you're a hosting company. And just the software, it's just a side project, basically. You need to have a good software, otherwise no one comes to you and buys your hosting. But at the end of the day, you're doing hosting. But that's a business model. Next example is partnership with funding organizations. This is always the idea. Yeah, you have this funding, these funds, or this other, or you have the Red Cross and some other organizations who do good things in the world in other areas, and you somehow partner with them and you associate your software with them and you somehow get some of their money. That's something, again, that's theoretically possible. I don't see a lot of examples for that. The next next thing is that, of course, free software and open source defines the licenses of the software. So it means that everybody should be able to use the software and distribute it and so on. But those licenses say nothing about certificates and trademarks. So it is possible that you name your software in a certain way and you own the trademark, and you don't allow anyone to use the trademark. So basically everybody can just take the software, but as soon as they somehow use it, they have to buy a license for the trademark from you. That's also theoretically possible. It's a bit weird. You don't get a big community if you basically, if no one can really use your software because the trademark is in the software, but it's something that's theoretically possible. You can ask for donations. This, again, is something a lot of projects do. We have a donate button on the website and people can donate money. Again, it's nice. I mean, I was involved in KDE, for example. This is something we do in KDE. And we get some money and we're able to pay, like, I don't know, one or two people for fundraising and event management and other things. But at the end of the day, this is, I don't see a lot of examples, or none basically, where donations can pay for the full development that really have like tens or hundreds of developers. Bounty-driven development, crowdsourcing is another example. It basically means that you have a software, let's say, I don't know, KDE as an example again, and then there's a website where people can say, hey, I really would like to have this feature. I want to have this blinking button here, and I'm willing to pay 10 euros for this feature. And then someone else sees this entry and thinks, well, I don't want to have the same button. I'm paying 15 euros. And then over time, there's more and more money comes together. And at some point, the money becomes, so much money comes together that a developer says, okay, well, that's nice. I really would like to do that. I will implement this feature and get the money from all the people. That's something that's possible. It exists in some cases. The problem is that people always pay for little features or fixes. They don't really pay for the overall maintenance of a software in this model. And there are some other problems. For example, if someone comes along and develops a feature for KDE, let's say, and then sends it to the KDE project, and the KDE project looks at it and thinks, well, that's not, I don't want that because it's, I don't know, not secure or not against the coding guidelines or against the strategy or whatever, and then rejects it, then the question is, what happens then? Right? I mean, technically the feature is developed but doesn't go upstream. So this is a bit challenging here. The next one is advertising. You can build software, distribute it, and have advertising in the product. You might think that, well, that's weird. No one would use that. I would never tolerate advertising in my software. Yeah, true. But I think most of you actually do, because Firefox is also using this model. Right? Firefox, of course, the open source browser is completely open source. Developed actually by hundreds of paid developers from Mozilla. The question is, where does the money come from? In this case, it mainly comes from Google, because Google actually pays Mozilla to be the default search engine in Firefox, which is not normal advertising. It's not really a blinking banner in your face, but it is definitely paid advertising. So yeah, that's a working model. It can work in some areas. In other areas, again, if you have to work with button blinking banners, then it's probably not such a good idea. Next model is delayed open source. That's a bit weird. I think there is this this PDF or PostScript render post. No, how is it called? I forgot. There's a PostScript renderer which still uses this model. The idea is that the software is proprietary and you have to pay to get it. But an older version, like the version from last year, is then automatically always open source. So the open source community gets like the old version of the software. And if you want to use the latest version, then you have to pay for it, which, yeah, doesn't really make it open source anymore, I guess. But that's the model that some people use. And of course, even weirder is then open source at end of life. It basically means that, hey, we have this software and it's proprietary and you can pay for it. But once we stop developing it, or maybe the company goes away or something else happens, then it automatically becomes open source. It's basically a guarantee for the users that they can always use the software, even if, I don't know, the producing company goes away, which again is weird. I wouldn't call this open source then at the end of the day. Okay, so these were the more weird business models. As you heard, I mentioned with most of them that it's not very popular. Now let's come to the last few ones that are actually successful and actually exist. The first is selling professional services or consulting. This basically means that you have a company, and you have lots of examples for that, by the way, but mainly smaller open source companies. They have a product, they have some product, doesn't matter, business product often, and it's open source, and lots of people use it. But then the user can come to them, company most of the time, and say, hey, there's a feature missing. I want to pay for the feature. And because it's often business software, they're actually willing to pay like lots of money, a few thousand euros for this feature. And then they develop this feature and they get the money and it's fine. The challenge is then that no one really pays for the real development of this, for the real maintenance and the core development of the software, which means it usually comes to scalability problems here. Or you organize workshops or trainings around the software. That's also something you can do. But again, this doesn't scale. And with not scaling, I mean that if you really want to grow, let's say you want to have double the income here from this company, then you need to have double the people for doing these trainings and workshops and paid development and so on. So this is why you see this model usually in smaller open source companies. I mean, there is no 1,000-person open source company which uses this model. The next, you can say, successful model is, of course, open core. This means that the software by itself is open source, but there are some pieces are there which are not open source. They are normal proprietary software, which means you can usually use the software for, I don't know, limited functionality, for example, or limited scalability or something. But then if you really want to use the real version, then you need to pay for it, and then you also get the proprietary pieces, and then you have the real solution. The challenge is, of course, then if you then pay for it, you just have, you no longer an open source relationship with the company. You're basically just a customer of those extensions. This is why I don't like that, because open source is here only used for marketing. It's getting people interested, and later you sell this then this other extensions or the enterprise edition. And if you then have this enterprise edition, then that's of course no longer open source. But that's a bit of a fake model, I think, here. And this is also the reason why a lot of people in the open source community don't really like this model. But there are quite some companies who use this model. The next option is dual licensing. The idea is that that the software is available under different licenses. So, for example, two, where one is an open source copyleft license, which means you can take the software and do whatever you want with it. But if this is GPL or AGPL software, then it of course comes with some restrictions, which is if you do changes, then you also have to open source the changes. And some companies might not like that. They might think, yeah, I want to use the software, but I don't like that. So they can buy or can get a software under a different license without the restriction, but then this costs money. This is used by the Qt company, I think, at the moment, also in the past by MySQL. I'm not really sure if they still do that, but that's the model here. Requires contributor license agreement, which means everybody who contributes needs to transfer the license to the company. And this is also very controversial because the producers somehow have special right that the normal community doesn't have. So it's not completely fair. And that leads me to the last business model. And I would think that this is the most successful one. This is the one with support subscriptions. And this is what Red Hat is using, what SUSE is using, Nextcloud 2, and many others. It basically means that the software is completely open source. You can take it, do whatever you want with it. But if you want to run it in a mission critical way, then you can get this kind of support insurance subscriptions, which basically means, hey, if something happens, I can help you, or if it doesn't scale, it doesn't help you if you have a security problem or something else. It's basically like an insurance, someone with the expert in the software, and that helps you if something happens. It has the benefit that it scales, which means if you sell double of those support subscriptions, you usually don't need double the people. And this is why it was possible that Red Hat, which is like the biggest open source company, of course, before it was bought by IBM, uses this model and is able to be very successful with it. And it also doesn't require code ownership, right? So Red Hat doesn't own the Linux kernel or something, but it's still able to sell subscriptions for Red Hat Enterprise Linux. I don't want to go into too much details what the subscription benefits could be. Also have to look after the time a little bit, but you basically get benefits in different areas. Your expertise, someone helps you basically if there's a problem with the software. Maybe you can influence the roadmap a bit. Maybe you have stability advantages, like you have like, I don't know, access to some special documentation or access to special bug fixes a little bit early or something like that. And then you might also have other things like guarantees that it's GDPR compliant and other things. Okay, and I think this is the best working open source business model that we have here at the moment. As I mentioned before, Red Hat is using this model and it's quite successful. Okay, so this was basically the world until a few years ago. But nowadays we have a new challenge. We have a new challenge, which is called cloud computing. And cloud computing changes a few things. It basically means that more and more is used as a service. So less companies actually host the software themselves in their basement. Lots of them consume it as a service. So you get like from Amazon, I don't know, MariaDB as a service or something else, and you don't really run it yourself. Or you basically get an operating system or some virtual machine from Google or Microsoft clouds, and you don't really care about operating system. It's just provided by the cloud provider. And you also don't need a Red Hat subscription anymore because the operating system is just something that's provided to you. And why should I buy support for it? It's just already guaranteed from Amazon that it works. So the support is usually provided by the cloud provider and you don't really need subscriptions anymore for the individual software pieces. That's a challenge for some companies, which led to some reactions in our community. The first is Redis. They introduced a common clause because they wanted to protect against this challenge. It basically means that Redis is, the source codes can still be distributed, but it forbids to sell the software or offer hosting or consulting without a commercial license. Right? It basically means, yeah, it's still open source in a way, but then not really in some use cases. Which again, I showed you the licenses, the four freedoms and the open source definition earlier. And they clearly say there should be no usage restrictions. So what they're doing here is this common clause. It's basically make it not open source anymore. Simon Phipps, president of the OSI at the time, he said, yeah, Redis just went proprietary. And that's of course correct because they introduced this restriction because they wanted to protect themselves against Amazon and other cloud providers. But this restriction makes it proprietary. Other companies that did the same, MongoDB introduced a server-side public license, which also has a similar direction. Anyone who wants to offer it as a service needs a commercial license or open the complete infrastructure, like the complete or the payment system and the complete backend, which is usually not possible, which again makes it proprietary. Okay, because basically, by protecting themselves against the cloud providers, they made their software proprietary. CockroachDB, same. They used the business source license. Again, no commercial services allowed without a commercial license. Okay, they basically try to force the big cloud providers to pay them. Okay, I saw this article on TechCrunch a few months ago, or years ago now. And it basically means common clause stops open source abuse. Right? That's the headline. And that's a bit of an interesting spin. This is why I want to mention it here, because it basically means that open source is somehow abused by these cloud providers. And common clause, this new license type, stops this abuse and somehow saves them open source. That's, of course, I really find it super irritating, the way of this marketing spin, because it basically means that you save open source by killing it, right? It basically means that, hey, it's, we call it open source according to our definition, which is not the official definition. The only thing we want, we introduce a few restrictions, no big deal, and everything stays like it is. Of course, that's wrong, because it goes against all of the four freedoms and all the principles of the community and of the different licenses that was developed the last 30 years. So that's really what's happening here at the moment. So it leads me to the last part. Copyleft licenses like GPL are great for business. I come up with a few examples why I disagree with this statement, and I actually think that the GPL is great for business. I disagree with this, with the actions of Redis and Mongo and others. Because as you know, Nextcloud is actually GPL or AGPL in some areas. And I think this works very well. And again, Red Hat is a great example why it works well. So I really disagree with that. First of all, the first reason why I believe that is it creates the best communities because all contributors are equal. So Nextcloud has over 2,000 contributors. And they only contribute to Nextcloud because we are all on the same playing field, right? Who wants to contribute to a company? Why would I want to give my time to a company? That's weird. But if it's basically the company is just another player and we are all in the same playing field and we own all the software together, then contributions are a lot more fair. So this creates the best communities. Forks are always possible. Which means if someone is not doing a good job, so if like we from the core team of Nextcloud are not doing a good job with the software, someone can always take it, fork it, and makes it better, which always enforces the best results, which is something that's only possible with the GPL. It's only possible with the GPL. All this other license doesn't allow it. It's always owned then by this one company, but something like Nextcloud or the Linux kernel is not owned by anyone. This is why it's better. Also, the global upstream and downstream network is possible, right? So if you have this standard license, GPL, AGPL or something, you can always like work together with other open source projects. You can exchange code upstream, downstream, it doesn't matter. That's only possible because of these standard licenses. If you have your special license or you need to give transfer ownership of your code to the company, then you can't take from other projects because there you don't have that. So this means that there are no code islands. For us, it's really nice that we are able to work with the best developers because they like open source. A lot of very good software developers really like open source, although from a philosophical perspective. And because we are completely open source, but same for other real open source companies, this basically means that it's great or easy for us to attract the best people because we are ethical and it's a fair open source business model. And if you change this to something that's fake open source or half proprietary or completely proprietary, well, then you don't get the best developers anymore. Also, ecosystems are very important. For example, Nextcloud has a lot of plugins and extensions and integration with other companies and other products. And that's something that's very nice, but it's only possible if everybody's in the same playing field. And the GPL actually enforces that everybody's on the same playing field. It means everybody has the same rights. The community governance, that's very that's an interesting topic. There are a lot of, not a lot of, but there are some open source projects, bigger ones like Kubernetes or OpenStack or something like that, who use like MIT or BSD, Apache style licenses. But it basically means that everybody can take it and make it proprietary, which means you need to have these foundations and you need to have foundation rules and governance rules, which makes sure that everybody who contributes to, let's say, Kubernetes plays nicely together with others, that no one takes it and makes it proprietary and so on. And that's not needed if you have the GPL. The GPL has these rules already baked into the licenses. So you need less of those governance and less of those foundations and the steering committees and stuff. Because, well, the GPL just says everybody can do the same and then the code quality decides. Customers really like GPL software because there's no vendor login. It means that, again, in the example of Nextcloud, sorry if I use Nextcloud all the time, they can use it. And then if they think that our enterprise subscription is valuable, then they can get it. And if they don't like it anymore, then they can cancel it. But they can keep on using Nextcloud, of course, because it's free software. And this gives them a lot of freedoms to the customers. And some business people might think, well, should I give freedoms to customers? I want to lock them in. But my opinion is if you play fair with everybody, if you have fair relations, you have happy customers, and then you have a lot of customers. You don't want to force them to pay you. Also, owning the code is not always important. It's a weird statement sometimes. The value of a company is in the people anyways. So this whole idea of that you have to own the software or something is also a bit outdated. The Red Hat CentOS strategy works great. I mean, as you might know, Red Hat Enterprise Linux and CentOS are very similar or close to identical, except some trademarks and logos and other things. And people can use CentOS for free if they like the software, the product. And if they want to have an enterprise subscription, then they get the Red Hat Enterprise Linux, but it's the same software. And this is a great strategy, and I think it works well. So locking in the customer is not always what you want. Customers like it, they can freely distribute and use it. Right? For example, here again with Nextcloud, we have some customers who use Nextcloud and they like to have the freedom that they can introduce it also in another department. They don't even need to talk with us. You can just like use it for another use case, and it basically is freely distributable and customers like that. And again, as I said, happy customers are good because then you're also successful. the way that contributions flow in and out of the company is also very helpful. That the GPL and HGPL enforces also customers that has to open source their changes, which then flows back upstream usually, and then helps everybody. Again, if you all collaborate together, then that's a good thing. And again, that's also possible only with GPL and HGPL and not with those common clause and other licenses. Another thing is that the licenses, GPL, HGPL, are clear and well understood. Right? They exist for many, many years. They're like tested in court, understood by a lot of lawyers. But these new licenses are completely unclear. So they're not well understood yet or tested. And I think it's always nice to go to a standard also here in licenses. Again, another argument where the GPL and HGPL is good. Copyleft software can never die or disappear. That's also something that our customers really like. They know if they introduce Nextcloud, then they can use Nextcloud forever. Doesn't matter if like we as a company make some mistakes or go away or I don't know, do something else. Nextcloud always stays there. And that's a benefit you have with copyleft software, GPL and HGPL. It never disappears. You can always use it. And that's again something that users and customers like, and this is why that's a good license. The patent protection is very good. That's something that's missing in all those other licenses, by the way. This common clause and business source and all these other licenses, they're usually derived from Apache or BSD style licenses, and they don't have the patent protection. So in GPL v3, there's the patent protection, which means that if you get the software and you use it, then you also automatically also get the right to use the patents that might affect it in the software. If you don't have this patent protection, it's minefield, because you introduce the software and then 2 years later, some weird patent holder somewhere could sue you. That's a risk, and that's not the case here. So let me give you some real world examples why the GPL is great. So this is something from the past, from my experience in the past, where from the OwnCloud times, we actually made a lot of mistakes. We actually introduced this copyright license agreement with dual licensing and open core, the business model I mentioned earlier. And this actually had the effect that contributors were unhappy and leaving the project. That's something we changed in Nextcloud, of course. Also, as I mentioned before, good developers really like to do open source work. And OwnCloud developers were not happy at the time because they had to use some proprietary extensions, the open core model again. Again, something we changed. Another thing that was a problem in the past was that customers were surprised about the vendor lock-in because they thought, well, it's in marketing, it says open source. And now I get it and I get the enterprise edition and then I cancel the contract. And then I'm surprised that I get a letter from a lawyer who says you can't keep on using the enterprise edition because enterprise edition is proprietary software, which makes the customers unhappy. Again, something that's fairer now. Of course, you might think, okay, what is Frank doing here in the talk? Because he's giving all these arguments why the GPL and HGPL are great for business. So why did these companies change their licenses? Are they stupid or why do Redis and Mongo and all the others, why do they change the license from GPL software to proprietary? So why did this happen, right? If I came up with all these arguments why it's a bad idea. So I think the answer might be, again, if I go back to this article on TechCrunch, where I showed you earlier, where this person said the common clause stops open source abuse. I think the answer to the question why this happens is if you scroll a little bit down, because then you can see that actually the writer of this article is actually the managing director of Brain Capital, a venture capital company. And this person is invested in all these different open source companies. He has a list on the right hand side. And he really thinks that this is there's a threat from Amazon against their companies. So I think the answer is here that these guys who are lobbying for this license change don't really want to save open source, as they said. They really want to save their all in own investment and their own companies. Okay, so this is about protecting their own interest and not protecting the interest of the open source community or of the software. And I think this is really something that's behind this whole license change, that that they invested lots of millions into these companies and they want to get it back somehow. So this is something they want to have. Actually, the health of the open source community, of the product or licenses or whatever, is not really something they're interested in. Okay, so I think this is the reason for this latest trends. This is just maximizing the return of investment here. So from my perspective, the summary is that Nextcloud and many other software would not exist without open source. Obviously not. All the benefits I mentioned earlier, they are so, so important. The GPL and HGPL is so important for software development. So open source, and I mean real open source as in a definition, it's really important. And without that, most of the software that exists today would not exist like that. And if we give up the four freedoms that Richard Stallman postulated at the very beginning of my talk here, then this is just for fast money. And this is not something we want to have. So let's not give up the four freedoms and our values for money. Thanks a lot for listening to my talk. I hope it was understandable. And I think we still have a few minutes for questions.
Thanks a lot. Yes, we do. Thanks a lot, Frank, for the great talk. Yeah, I have a long list of questions, and I think we probably have time to do all of them.
Okay.
So the first question is, what is your opinion on how to address the cloud challenge? Do we need to redefine what distribution means in the GPL?
Excellent question. I see that we have some experts here in the talk. Yeah, I don't think we need to change the licenses or the freedoms at all. I think open source is fine as it is today. It's true that some companies might, as the article writes, abuse open source, which means in this case, they're not really abusing open source. It means they use the software without paying the company, which is something that's always fine. I mean, obviously, right? Does everybody who's using Linux paying Red Hat? No, of course not. And I also think it's not needed, so it's fine. There are still a lot of benefits. What you can do. I mean, you get all this this marketing, the awareness, the developer, the community out of it. So I don't think if you really have a problem. You have a problem if you have these companies that have like millions and millions of investment, which means that you are. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, we can see it.
Ah, okay, so because the screen went off. Okay. I think you have if this company is with millions and millions of investment, then I don't know if everybody knows how venture capital works, but this basically means that they really need to generate millions and billions of revenue to pay back those evaluations, basically. And that's something that might not be possible if Amazon hosts your software. But at the end of the day, I think there's always a bigger market for your software. Also, there's a little bit of a pushback to the whole cloud thing, right? There's more and more on-premise software. That's at least what we hear now. So I think there is no real problem. I think the problem is only exists if you really want to turn Redis into the next Oracle or something.
Thanks. Next question is, do you have any tips on how to attract contributors to a project?
Well, many, many things. I mean, first of all, it needs to be useful software. It needs to be useful for the contributors themselves. So if you're building some kind of weird business application, then don't expect that a lot of students help you with that because they don't really use it. So it should be something that's useful for a lot of people. Then also the contribution should be easy. So it should not be like, I don't know, sending weird emails to someone and then getting no response and then emailing patches around. You really a nice workflow, like use some of the modern Git tools that makes the contribution really, really easy and build a real community. Fair licenses, as I said before, I think I'm a big fan of GPL and AGPL because it enforces that everybody is on the same playing field. You need to be nice. You have a code of conduct. You need to have like a friendly, open community, nice to each other. Right? And you need to enforce that. So if someone wants to willingly or unwillingly harm your community by introducing bad communication, then you need to stop that. You need to make sure that's a happy place. There are many, many things. I don't know if I can summarize everything, but I think this should be the main points.
Yeah, that's good. Next question is, when you're talking to customers in your job as at Nextcloud, what reasons for using Nextcloud do you hear from them?
Sorry, say it again. Why do they?
What are the reasons? Why are your customers choosing Nextcloud?
Yeah, I mean, why do they choose Nextcloud? I think there are two reasons. First of all, you need to have a software that fits their needs. And the second is, of course, they need to hear from it. So first of all, you need to have a good software. That's something that, yeah, you need to have a good team to build really nice software. And you need to open source also helps with that, right? Because you get a lot of feedback, contributions and bug reports and everything from the outside, which helps you making a good product. And then the second part is, of course, people need to know that it exists. This is why some marketing is needed. But we as Nextcloud has really no marketing budget. So for us, it's very important that the community is also using it and spreading the words. So we have a lot of fans out there who tell everybody that Nextcloud is great and Nextcloud exists. And this helps us to get in contact with potential customers.
Nice. Yeah. There are two more questions. I think we will be able to do both of them.
Okay.
What has been the most rewarding in the Nextcloud adventure experience for you as a person?
It's always the feedback from the users. I mean, it's always like if you at FOSDEM, for example, one of those open source events, and you have to stand behind a table, and then someone comes along and says, "Hey, I just want to say thanks. Using it is great. Thanks a lot," and that's it. And it's like, wow, that's. I don't know. It's just the feeling that you have a positive effect on the world and people. And if you really have like people who appreciate the work and say, "Hey, that's good. I like it. I use it," that's very rewarding. I mean, at the end of the day, Nextcloud, and I think it's the same for lots of other communities. It's a bit of idealistic reason, right? We want to improve the world and protect the data and increase the security and so on. And then if people come to you and say, "Yeah, I use it. It's great. Thank you." Then that's, that's very rewarding.
Yeah, nice. One last question. What is the most important thing, in your opinion, to think about when starting a project with the business in mind?
Oh, there are so many things. How many hours of time do I have? I don't know. It's so many things. I mean, you need to find something that's really needed. You need to analyze. There's also the saying, go where the puck is going, not where the puck is today, for the ice hockey players of you. So you need to somehow predict where is what's a good idea. Where there's a market, where there's some demand for, then and then just usual good building a great team, of course, good name, good strategy, working together with the community, which is very helpful to give you feedback because no one has all the answers. You always need to communicate with the community to come up with the right answers and to fix mistakes that you might otherwise do. There's so many things.
We don't need to list them all, I think.
No, we can't.
Thank you, and thanks again for a great talk. It's been really interesting to listen to.
Thanks a lot, and thanks for joining, and enjoy the rest of this awesome virtual conference here.
And with that, I would like to thank our speakers, our sponsors, and all our viewers.